So hi everyone, my name is Kareem, and today I'm going to present the work we accomplished while being here at KAUST, being supervised by Mr. Ningi and Professor Thanos. So in my presentation, it consists of four parts. First of all, an introduction, then a background, then an analysis of the problem, finish up with the results. So this device is called the Crooks Radiometer. It consists of four vanes. Each vane has a black and a white side, and the gas inside is of a very low density. And this is how it works. So if you were to shine light, the vanes are going to rotate. So your first intuition on why is that should be something like this. Well, since light is fundamentally photons which carry momentum, it must be that these photons are hitting the vanes in a certain way to produce this circular motion. And given the fact that white objects reflect light while black objects do absorb them, it's obvious that the difference in momentum in this case is much greater. From that, this resembles the white objects since it reflect photons that hit them, and this resembles the black objects. So since the difference in momentum here is greater, thus would be the force. So eventually we would expect that the force on the white side of the vanes will be greater, so the rotation must be counterclockwise in this direction. But as you can see, this is totally not counterclockwise, it's just the opposite. So maybe there's another effect which plays the essential role in this phenomenon. And after the work of many scientists and engineers, the accepted explanation is due to a phenomenon called thermal creep. So as you know, basically the thing is that the black side of the vein is going to get hotter, because as you know from everyday experience, you should really avoid wearing black on sunny days. In Saudi, you should not wear black at all. The black side of the vein will get hotter compared to the white side, and what temperature essentially is, microscopically speaking, is a measure of how fast the molecules of an object are randomly moving. So if this is the vein, the dark side of the vein is vibrating more intensely compared to the white side. And therefore, it would have more violent collisions with the gas molecules nearby compared to the white side. So the conclusion is that now, since we have a greater force on the black side, the rotation would be clockwise as observed. It's not so simple. There is one complication that I did not mention about the recalled gas molecules. So since the gas molecules that hit the black side of the vein would rebounce with greater velocities compared to those that hit the white side. So these recalled gas molecules would block the incoming molecules, and this blocking effect would be greater on the dark side compared to the white side. Eventually, these two effects, the vibration of the vein and the blocking, would result in balancing out the total forces on the vein, resulting in a net force that equal to zero. This statement holds true for every single interior point of the vein, but not on the edges. So, you could see that the problem has some complications. It has been around since the 1870s. Many famous scientists and engineers have worked on the problem, including Maxwell, Einstein, and Lord Kelvin. Now a question arises of why should one pursue such a problem? Well, as far as science is concerned, we just want to know the reason why certain phenomena happens in a particular way. On the other hand, in the point of view of applications, I will mention three possible applications. One, basically goes that any kind of microelectromechanical machine could utilize such kind of design like the Crookes Radiometer, since it really it's relatively simple to generate energy just by having a gas of certain density. Another application would be if you were to describe thermal creep accurately, then you would have a relation between the rotation of the vanes and the properties of the gas inside. Therefore, you would know some information about the molecular measurements of the gas. Eventually, and lastly, I mean, engineers could utilize the same design of the Crookes radiometer to manufacture jet plane engines that operate on high altitudes. Now moving to the second part. So a phenomenon like the thermal creep and the thermal stress flow cannot happen in the usual conditions of Navier-Stokes flows, meaning a flow in which the pressure gradient is not so great and the temperature conditions are usual. But in the case of the Crookes radiometer, the flow there is rarefied, so it allows such two phenomena. Therefore, we cannot use Navier-Stokes equation is not suitable to describe such phenomena, but a modified version, which Mr. Ming did explain about the called the Crookes, the Navier-Stokes quarterback model, could do the job. And here are two reasons why to believe so. The first would be the Hamiltonian formalism. So the Hamiltonian formalism is a way of describing any physical system by taking into account a quantity called the action, which possesses the property of being invariant, meaning that if you were to take a physical system and do any kind of transformation whatsoever, whether it's a gauge transformation, an internal one, the action would possess its form. Then by implementing the calculus of variation, you would be able to derive the equations that describe the system as time evolves. So an example of doing that is in classical mechanics, for example. If you would write down the appropriate action, you'd end up with the equations of motion. In the case of electromagnetism, you would get Maxwell equations. Say if you have quantum mechanics, you'd end up with Schrodinger equation. And in our particular case of fluid mechanics, if you were to write down the appropriate action, you'd have Navier-Stokes quarterback equation, which gives you somehow a feeling of how fundamental that model is. Now the second reason would be what Mr. Ming has presented about this possible reduction from the kinetic theory of gases into a model that belongs to continuum mechanics. And this is quite common, that if we have one domain of physical phenomena and then there exists more than one theory, so we ask about the relation between them. One example would be of classical and quantum mechanics. So both theories claim very different nature of the same domain of physical events. So then how could both be valid to a certain degree? So we could describe that by saying that the whole complexity of quantum mechanics reduces to the simple classical mechanics in the case that some constant h bar goes to zero. Another example would be of wave and geometrical optics. So we know that light has some wavy nature, but in our domain and scale, it's really sufficient to deal with light as simply straight lines. So we could phrase it as that the whole complexity of light behaving as a wave do reduce to simply behaving as straight lines, in the limit that the wavelength of light is too small compared to the physical system. So eventually we have this reduction from wave optics into geometrical optics in the limit that some constant goes to a certain limitation. And although what concerns us here of the kinetic theory of gases and fluid mechanics is still not quite have been done totally, still some missing steps and some theorems, some theorems need to be proven, but still more or less we have this relation between the kinetic theory of gases and Navier-Stokes-Korteweg equation. So these are the two reasons, one that comes from the Hamiltonian formalism and the other from this possible reduction from the kinetic theory of gases into Navier-Stokes-Korteweg. Moving to the third part, so Maxwell himself did analyze the Crookes radiometer, and he came up with a model, let's call it Maxwell model, which did describe the thermal creep to a certain degree, but fails to describe other phenomena related to fluids in which the capillary effects are not negligible. On the other hand, Navier-Stokes-Korteweg equation do describe these other phenomena just fine. So since the Crookes radiometer has a complicated geometry, it would really be difficult to apply Navier-Stokes-Korteweg equation to it directly. Therefore, our job was to consider simpler setups and to try to apply Navier-Stokes-Korteweg equation and Maxwell model, see if one indicates the other and if they are equivalent. Just again, the very first simple setup was that if you have a fluid and two spheres are submerged in it, the two spheres could have either...
What kind of spheres?
So, like, I mean, does not need to be any special ones.
Okay.
We're just trying to figure to see the effect that
okay.
that they will get attracted if their temperature are higher than the surrounding meaning the fluid. On the other hand, they will get repelled if their temperature were lower.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, the thing is that the situation could be reduced into a familiar one, in which we have a fluid under control, meaning that it's been isolated, and we could assign a temperature to the extreme points. That is being done if we were to look at the equation of motion. Then we have Maxwell model claiming that the total stress is, well, as we know before, there is the regular pressure term, then the viscosity term, and lastly, it's the term being claimed by Maxwell model, which has this form. For Navier-Stokes-Korteweg model, the total stress would be similar, but now the extra term would have this form. So the thing is that in a very simple flow, the properties of the gas like temperature, density, and pressure could have a wide range of values. But two extreme cases would really simplify the calculations, and it would give interesting results. The first extreme would be if the pressure is to be controlled, meaning that it's constant, or if there is no flow, meaning that the acceleration is zero or that the velocity is constant. So according to Euler equation, if you have such situation that say the pressure is constant, then obviously there is no flow, and vice versa. So if you have no flow, that it means, according to Euler equation, that the pressure is constant everywhere. So these two statements are interchangeable. But what actually happens, and is predicted exactly by Maxwell model, that if, say, we have this situation, and there were to be no flow, this means that the pressure is higher at the region of high temperature. And the other case would be that if, say, pressure is to be constant everywhere, then there will be a flow from the region of low temperature to the region of high temperature. So we need to make sure that Navier-Stokes-Korteweg equation do predict at least these two effects. So for the first case, in which velocity is constant, one problem with Euler-Korteweg equation is that there are some degrees of freedom. meaning that there are some parameters that need to be assigned or need to be measured, but in our case we did not know them. So then we need to make sure that two statements are really mutually exclusive. The first, that if the parameters were to be wrong, I mean, if there was something wrong with them, then no solution would be obtained. And the other statement would be that if, say, that the parameters were somehow good, then we would have a solution, and on top of that, the pressure would behave like temperature, meaning that both will either increase or decrease. So they will behave similarly. So we really need to make sure of these, that these two statements are really mutually exclusive. So setting down the boundary, the conditions that we have, as well as the equations, since we said that the velocity is constant, meaning that Newton's law would result in the divergence of the total stress being equal to zero, would then need to postulate a form of C. A reasonable one would be of this form. Then eventually you would be able to come up with the form of TK, which would look like this. So now, after being able to finding out the form of TK, just to sum up the conditions that we have. So we said before that the temperature is priori assigned, so we could choose whatever kind of temperature. Also from the symmetry of the problem, we could deduce these three conditions. And finally, this is one last free parameter that we have. So we could play with the value of the pressure at the middle. So eventually we will end up with this system of ODEs. We did try a Rancotta method to solve it, and we obtained two results, I will show up two results. So in this case, we did choose a behavior of temperature, which is decreasing. So the red line is temperature, and the blue squares are the pressure. So you could see that they did behave similarly. I mean, they are both increasing, and even their shape is quite similar. One other interesting thing is how density is behaving. It's almost constant all over the domain. The other function that we choose for temperature was an increasing one. So here, the two functions of temperature and pressure are somehow different. But the thing that we needed to check eventually is that if they both behave similarly, meaning that they both increase or decrease. So here they do both increase. So that was for the first case in which there is no flow, meaning that the velocity is constant. I did mention before that we needed to make sure that two statements are really mutually exclusive. One being that if we had a solution, then pressure and temperature need to behave similarly. The other was that if the parameters were to be inserted badly, then no solution would occur. We would not have a wrong solution. So we did verify that. I mean, we did play with that value of the pressure in the middle, as well as other free parameters that we had. And in every single time, we did not obtain any solution. So for the other case, in which now the pressure is constant, since we know that pressure is nothing but the multiplication of temperature and density, and if it's constant, then we could scale it up at whatever value we want. The simplest would be 1. So then we have the temperature to be simply 1 over rho. So for Maxwell models, and since this is the form of TM, the extra term, the total stress, it could be easily manipulated for the 1D case to eventually be equal to a constant multiplied by the second derivative of temperature. For Euler-Korteweg equation, we could do the same. Eventually, we would reach this form. So now, alpha and L2 depends on the properties of the fluid, which were postulated before as C. So if L and A were to be measured and then inserted, it could be that these two equations would have eventually the same sign for, say, if L minus alpha is a positive number. So these two equations would indicate the same direction of stress. So the conclusion is that in the very simple case that we did consider of a 1D flow, we did in particular specify two conditions, two extreme cases. One is that the pressure is controlled and the other is that there is no flow. In this, when we furthermore analyze these two scenarios, we find out that Navier-Stokes-Korteweg equation and Maxwell model do give similar results, and they do indicate each other. So this was my presentation. If you have any question, then please do not ask, because there is no point. We could either talk outside or you could ask Mr. Ming.
You said
please.
The density is low. How low the density was?
So in the
inside
proximal.
This, yeah.
So actually, if it were totally vacuum, then nothing would happen, right? And if it were at room pressure, at the atmospheric pressure,
then
it will not also rotate.
Okay.
Since,
okay, yeah.
That's the usual Navier-Stokes flow.
Mm-hmm.
But just if the Knossian number, the free mean path length, if it were be exactly like the dimension of the veins, then it will have the maximum motion, meaning that the veins will rotate the most. So like few centimeters across.
Okay.
So that would be the Knossian number, but exactly of the density.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure.
Okay.
So any other question?
What's the conclusion?
I said that in this very particular case, we eventually wanted to know if Navier-Stokes-Korteweg equation and Maxwell model both describe thermal creep, right? Because eventually Navier-Stokes-Korteweg equation is somehow a better model, right? So in the very setup that we did consider, it did do so.
Was it easy to find the parameters for which it does it, or it was quite robust?
It will not take like more than 5 minutes to figure out really the good ones.